Welcome to George Mason University's Studio A. My name is Rick Davis, and today our guest is writer, director, producer Ron Maxwell. Ron Maxwell, a long and distinguished career, has written many film and television programs, including The Guest, Let There Be Light, In the Land of the Poets, and most recently Gettysburg and Gods and Generals, which is part of a prospective Civil War trilogy. In addition to directing most of the above, Mr. Maxwell has produced and directed such films as Sea Marks, Verna, USO Girl, which was an Emmy nomination for Best Director, and he directed the films Little Darling, Kidco, Parent Trap 2, and The Night the Lights Went Out in Georgia. Please, again, welcome Ron Maxwell. So, Ron, we're going to begin at the beginning of your career. What was the first film you worked on professionally, and what was your role?
Well, there are a number of films you can call the first film. The first film could be the one that I shot on Super 8. It could be the 3-minute black and white one I shot on 16 millimeter in a summer course at NYU. Or I could consider it the thesis film I did at NYU grad school, which was an adaptation of Albert Camus' The Guest from a collection of short stories called Exile in the Kingdom, which was set in the late 50s in the high Algerian plateau. Or you could say it's the first time somebody paid me to make a film, which would probably be a few years later, and the first one that I directed, employed as a director, was Sea Marks, which I made for WNET 13 in 1976, which we filmed in Ireland with George Hearn and Veronica Castang. Originally, it had been a stage production at the Manhattan Theater Club, and it was part of a series called Theater in America, where we at 13 were trying to capture what was becoming a national theater movement. Theaters like the ACT and Trinity Square.
The regional theater.
The regional theater movement, and we went around and captured their productions. It was a departure on my particular project because all of them were done in multi-camera videotape, and I was arguing for film, and I finally convinced Jack Venza, the executive producer and one of the elder statesmen at public television now, to let me go and do a cinema film adaptation of a two-person play, which was done at the Manhattan Theater Club. We took it off the Stark stage at the Manhattan Theater Club with the two actors and opened it up and filmed it on location in the west of Ireland. That was a wonderful experience.
The other shows in that series were done in the theater environment, on
yes,
stage.
Yes.
And you were the first to break it out and actually make a film
right
in that setting. So you took a stage play. I know that in your background is also some theater work.
Mm-hmm.
I'm told that at NYU you played the role of Hamlet at one point.
Oh, that this too solid flesh would melt, thaw, and resolve itself into a dew. Yes, I did.
Very good. Yes, and you still got it. How did that help you prepare for your later work in film?
Well, I think I've understood from the beginning what an actor does. And therefore, I can, as a director, I can help the actor get to where he needs to get, and direct the actor to achieve the results that I'm looking for without giving the results to the actor. In other words, I understand that an actor has a process that should be organic to arrive at what you want, and the actor has to do it. I can't do it. So I don't think I've ever given a line reading in my life to an actor. I let the actor get to what is authentic for the actor.
Mm-hmm.
So being an actor when I was young, certainly, and having that education as an undergraduate in theater department at NYU, provided me with that insight into what an actor does. And as a result, I've had nothing but enormous respect and understanding for that process. And I protect that process because if the process is protected, what you get is not the actor's bag of tricks, but actually something that could be quite extraordinary.
Or alternatively, the imprint of your own version of the performance on the actor, that it becomes their own original product.
Yes. You get something that is different than what you might have thought when you approached, because the actors, as we all know, no two actors are going to play the same role the same way. Witness Martin Sheen, Robert Duvall. two, I would say, valid, authentic interpretations of Robert E. Lee, mm-hmm. but very different the one from the other.
Speaking of notorious or famous or distinguished actors, earlier in your career, I think maybe before you made your directing debut, you worked with Charlton Heston on Antony and Cleopatra as an assistant mm-hmm. on that show. What was that like?
Well, I just had my newly minted Master of Fine Arts degree from the NYU, and I spent a few months getting his coffee and arranging tennis champions to meet him. We were filming in Spain, in the south of Spain, in the Costa del Sol, which we called the Costa del Hielo at the time. But but we were filming there, and so I'd have to find the great tennis champion at the time of Spain and fly him down from Madrid to the Costa del Sol. Typical assistant work,
right.
You know.
Yeah.
But it was a great experience in many ways to work with him because he was a transition from another Hollywood. And because I was among the first generation of formally educated filmmakers, it was interesting to see what it was like, what had previously happened in the whole history of cinema when there were no film schools. Mm-hmm. You were apprenticed to someone, and that's how you learned whatever your job would be. And so in that sense, it was wonderful to apprentice with someone who had that connection back to the heyday of, yeah. Of DeMille and William Wyler and all those great directors yeah. that he worked with. You can name any number of them.
Well, I want to return to that question of mentorship and influence, but I want to turn to our students in the audience because I know they have some questions for you. We'll take a few questions from the audience. Yes, sir.
Hi, my name is Nathan, and I'm a senior film student at Mason. I was wondering, how did you work your way up to be a director?
Well, it's I was putting on a show, let's say, in its primitive state. I was putting on shows at a very early age. Basically, when I could read and write, I was already putting on a show in the house or in the garage. I mean, I really started young, and I was doing what I'm doing now before I had any understanding that it was a career or a life's calling. I just was doing it. And so by the time I got into junior high school, I was writing three-act plays and producing them and directing them. And sometime around 12, I remember watching a BBC series that was broadcast. I lived in the New York metro area at the time. It was called An Age of Kings, and it was Richard II through Richard III. And it made such an impression on me. It was just a window into this extraordinary universe of Shakespeare. His histories, and I started then writing plays in blank verse and iambic pentameter, and produced two of them at school. The first one was Charles I, and the second one was Henry III, because there were two that Shakespeare had overlooked. But I say this because it was a seamless, organic process with me, so that I naturally was a theater major when I went to college. I considered myself already a veteran thespian by the time I went to college, and then went to grad school to learn how to make movies. So it's really unchanged. The part of your question is, how do you break into the profession? And that is just putting yourself in harm's way. That is going where people are using what talents for what you want to do. If you're a documentary filmmaker, you should go different places. If you want to make narrative film, the way that the world is still set up, it was set up that way in the late 60s and 70s when I was starting out, well, you have to go to one of the places where they're doing narrative films, which is New York or LA, and that's the great pilgrimage that people go on and work as waiters and busboys and taxi drivers and construction and whatever, while they're trying to be actors and writers and directors.
Do we have another question? Yes, sir.
Hi, Mr. Maxwell. My name is Nicholas Carrot, and I'm studying at George Mason to become a director. And one of the questions I have for you is, what made you decide to go into writing and directing instead of editing and other aspects of film?
Well, I'm a storyteller. And so I've always done everything, including painting the scenery and finding the costumes and the wigs and selling the tickets. I mean, I approached from such an early age that it was only later on that I understood that there were career paths. And so as a storyteller, I went as a theater major to a study film in grad school, and I started making movies, you're doing, again, everything. You're editing the movies, and you're shooting the movies for someone else's movie, that's the path I took. So I was the filmmaker, the storyteller, because I had stories that I wanted to tell. The technology changes. There will be technology 500 years from now, or even 100 years from now, that we can't even imagine. But the storyteller will be the same, just as the storyteller was the same at the time of Shakespeare, and the storyteller was the same at the time of Sophocles. The storytellers are always among us. The technology changes. So as the technology changes, you have to master the tools. That's our palette and our paintbrush. And certainly that's something that's a craft that you acquire with applied practice. So because I have stories to tell, I wouldn't just be the editor, because the editor, like the cameraman, is putting their talent and their art and their craft at the service of another intellect. Because filmmaking is the job, with rare exception, like the Coen brothers, it's one intellect that synthesizes everything. It's a work of art. Could be a bad work of art, but it's a work of art. And so it's synthesized through one intellect. And then the other intellects, which make enormous contributions, to be sure, the actors, the cinematographer, the editors, are serving that intellect. And it's where you find your talent and where you find your gift and how it fits in the movie-making process. Some editors become directors, such as Robert Wise, who edited The Magnificent Ambersons and went on to direct many movies, including The Sound of Music. It used to be a more prevalent path in the old days than it is now.
You know, so many of your remarks the last couple of minutes have had to do with the passing on of craft and of skill, the mentorship idea, the generations. You're talking about Charlton Heston being under the influence of Wyler and the greats. Do you have a single most important mentor or single most important influence even that's guiding your film career?
I've been so lucky. I had some wonderful mentors. They're all gone, alas. There's a poignant phrase in the introduction to Samuel Johnson's dictionary, which I encourage everyone to read. And he says that now that he's finished his labors, and he spent 15, 20 years on it, all the people he wished to impress or to please were in the grave. Mm. And it gives you a perspective on the price of art and the price of an artistic life. My mentors are all gone. My father, I'd have to name number one, who read to me before I could read, who imbued me with the love of literature before I could read, so that when I could read, I was voracious and have remained voracious to this moment. My father, who took me to historical sites, we lived in New Jersey, so I didn't see any Civil War sites, but I saw sites from the colonial era and the American Revolution and the War of 1812 and up and down. So I'd say my father, number one. Then I had some wonderful professors. My camera professor at NYU, Baderick Batka, who had just, when I was starting film school in 67, managed to get a visa to shoot a movie outside of Czechoslovakia, and of course, never went back. Hmm. And he was not only a terrific connection to the Eastern European cinema, which was a different cinema than the Hollywood cinema. And we talked about image and framing and storytelling and all sorts of things. But he was also a witness right in front of me to totalitarianism, which I didn't understand. And I was a long-haired hippie protesting the war at the time. And I didn't really understand what that was about until I met him. And he brought home to me vividly the horror of what it was like to live in a totalitarian regime, and how emancipated and liberated he felt being able to come to America. An enormous friendship, an enormous mentor, profoundly a mentor on things artistic and things aesthetic. The actor Richard Jordan, also gone. We met early on in New York. I forget how we met and when we met, but we bonded and became great friends. He wasn't that much older than me, 10, 12 years older than me. but an aesthetic bond and a sense of aesthetics that he imbued me with. We would talk about Shakespeare, we would talk about literature, about plays. And the wonderful thing about those people who have the deep, when you make a deep aesthetic connection, is you can freely disagree about anything, but it'll never break your bond because you're meeting in some deep, deep place of aesthetics. Tad Danielewski, who directed the film No Exit, based on Jean-Paul Sartre's play, with Vivica Lindfors, and sometime in the late 50s, early 60s. Met him at an acting workshop while I was at NET 13 in the early 70s. We started a friendship. He was a wonderful mentor. He always had acting, he coached actors. He coached Sigourney Weaver and many, many actors who are of repute today. He later on became a professor at Brigham Young University, headed up the theater department there. We always stayed in contact. Every time I had a draft of a script, I sent it to him. He gave me his notes. Every time there was a production of his, I would go see it. Every time there was an edit of one of my movies, he'd come and see the picture when it was 7 hours long or 6 hours long and give me his notes. How wonderful, how invaluable those mentors were to me. They're all gone. I hope I have retained some of their wisdom.
That's quite a collection. And what I hear is a synthesis of craft, art, and content or subject matter. It seems that you're as driven by subjects as you are by the visuals or the aesthetics of film.
Oh yeah, yeah. It's
why make the movie?
Why do this script versus that script? And I tell everybody, and I'm telling you now, it's a good idea in the long run if you want to go into film to take a vow of poverty. Not because there will be a lot of hard times and a lot of lean times, which of course there will, but because when the times get fat, you can lose your soul by doing projects you're not called to do, by the little voice that gets drowned out by all the noise, by everybody telling you what you should be doing, and by the money. It corrupts. Mm. And to listen to that little voice and say, even though they're offering me all this money to do this script, it's this script I should do. Mm-hmm. Because this is the one I'm called to do. This is what my unique contribution is to do this script. 100 people could do that script, but only I can do this script. And that takes some discipline. And it takes getting very quiet in your soul to listen to that little voice so that your life as an artist is used the way you are called to use it, not by the way other people wish to use it.
Well, I hear the word voice and the word calling coming from you, and I know you're working on a film on Joan of Arc, and we'll get back to that in a moment. But, well, you've made a lot of films, or several important films, out of historical subjects. The Civil War, now Joan. Making art out of history is always fraught with interesting perils. How do you reconcile the need for historical truth, if there is such a need, with that other kind of truth that the artist makes?
Well, any film is ultimately, undeniably, an act of the imagination. And if you make a film, or I make a film about a certain event, it's going to be two different films. Just like I said earlier, two actors are not going to give the same character portrayal of the same character, like Robert E. Lee. So it intrinsically, it's going to have your personality in it, because you can't take yourself out of it. You are drawn to the subject because things attract you to it, which reflects the choices you're going to make. Having said that, then, one must try to keep oneself out of it to the extent possible, I believe, if you're doing a historical subject, and try to be true to the historical people and try to bring them to life, to breathe life into them, to have a kind of a cinematic resurrection. Otherwise, what you end up with is something phony or propagandistic, which ultimately, why bother? Why even go down that road? If we make a historical film, it's because we want to get close to those people and bring those people again close to us. But the way, ironically, we bring them close to us is not by bringing them into the 21st century and to have them imbued with attitudes that belong on Rodeo Drive, for instance, but we must go there. It's the inverse. We must go to the 15th century where Joan of Arc lived, or we must go to the 19th century where Thomas Jackson lived, and understand what that life was like and who they were. And in seeing them, in meeting them where they live, without judgment, I underline without judgment. Mm-hmm. Judgment is propaganda. No judgment. To go and illuminate the lives where they live, this takes a certain discipline. And again, listening to their lives, to recreate their lives in as much historical detail as possible.
You're in the process of making a film or finishing a film called Resistencia, the Civil War in Nicaragua, which is historical, perhaps even more so than a fiction film because it's a documentary. How's that treating you? How's that different?
Well, I'm being reminded in excruciating detail every day why it is I don't do documentary films. Because they're not a picnic. A narrative film, you write a script, you shoot the script, you edit the script. Of course things change, and of course in the editing you could spend, as I did on Gods and Generals, 9 months in post-production finding the film in all the footage that you shot on a scripted script. But documentaries, you're really dealing with a great big block of granite, and you've got to be a Rodin and find the thinker in the middle of that. It's a different process, it's a different discipline, and I'm reminded that it's not where my talents lie. I got involved in that film more out of a sense of citizenship duty because I wanted to give a voice to the Nicaraguan democratic resistance that was caught between two extremes and was being utterly ignored by the American press and American filmmakers who were rushing to make propaganda films. And I found it at the time an outrage that these people were being ignored. I went to give them a voice. And 2 years later, lo and behold, they won the election, the free election in Nicaragua. But I couldn't finish it at the time because I ran out of time and money. And it lay fallow for almost 20 years. I finally recently got the money to finish it. And suddenly I'm a slightly older gentleman making a movie that I had passion for 20 years ago. And I'm finding it's a different energy. And it's very challenging to finish the film.
And your energy now is in the 15th century with Joan.
It's true.
How is that Joan going to be different from other Joans that have come before? There's some famous cinematic Joans, and of course one famous play, Bernard Shaw.
Joan, I have no doubt, as we're sitting here today, will be made into movies countless times in the coming decades and centuries, as long as there is a humanity, that humanity will want to tell her story. It's one of the archetypal stories. Why did I want to do it? I was called by that little voice I was talking about earlier. No one else has called me. As a matter of fact, every other voice has told me not to do
Stay away.
but I listened to those little voices. I've learned that to trust that little voice and give it space and then put my life behind it, my energy behind it. And along the way, I have found out what it is that I have to tell about this story that other filmmakers have not told. There have been at least 15 feature films on theatrical feature mm-hmm. films on Joan of Arc since the dawn of cinema. The Méliès brothers made one. And it is what I want to explore first and foremost among the many themes that are valid and interesting, a woman in a man's world, all sorts of themes. Civil War, again, that has mm-hmm. this in common with my other films because there is a civil war going on in France between the Armagnac faction and the Burgundian faction. Issues of faith certainly are prominent. But the core issue that I wanted to explore is the mystery of the calling.
Mm-hmm. Let's turn back to our students, and we have time for a couple more questions from our wonderful audience. Who's next? Yes, sir.
Hi. My name is Paula Catapang. I'm also a film student here at George Mason University. And my question is, what was your toughest obstacle you had to overcome on your way to becoming an established director?
Well, when you go to wherever you're going, to New York or you go to LA, I suppose it's not an unusual feeling to say, I am lost here. I'm nobody. I mean, I'm invisible. I am off the radar. I mean, how do you even get noticed? And so what happens, what a lot of filmmakers do, I resisted it, and I'm not saying that anybody should follow my example, certainly, is they feel like they have to do something sensational to get noticed. And I understand why, because how do you stand out between all the other millions of filmmakers who are showing up on Hollywood Boulevard? And so there is this kind of sensational attempt to shock or to be different to get attention. And sometimes it works, and some careers have started that way. I think if that's who you are, then do that. But if it's not who you are, then don't do that. I think you got to remember who you are and stick to the stories you want to tell. Because there's such a thing as a career, and you can pursue a career, but there's such a thing as stories you really want to tell. And filmmakers, I believe, however egotistical they may be, however they may want to have the Mercedes and the big swimming pool, fine, that's normal. We all want that. But what the filmmaker really has to offer is his uniqueness and his desire to tell a certain story. There are stories I know you're burning to tell. And that's what you got to hold on to. Now, sometimes you can't get to tell that story right away because they don't want to hear that story. But at the end of the day, that's what we really want. That's what humanity wants from you. That's what I want from you, and that's what you want from you, to tell your own story. And so if you hang on to that, in the long run, that's what gets noticed, and that's what starts the lasting careers, because you are unique, you're yourself, and you're not just out there pandering to get a job or to get a short-term goal.
Great. Anybody else have a question?
My name is Dennis Monin. I'm a junior in the film department here. I was just wondering, what's the single most important piece of advice you have to give to aspiring filmmakers such as us?
Well, it's probably my theme that I've been, to thine own self be true, getting back to Hamlet. I'm saying, I know that it probably sounds a little bit cliche, but when you throw yourself into the fray, you will see how difficult that is. And like I said to the gentleman here, I'm interested in your story, what interests you as a filmmaker, the stories you want to tell. And stick to it. I mean, you got to stick to it because the initial response you're going to get is, we're not interested. But what about this? But what about this? And so that's what you have to scrutinize to make sure. Look, I can't tell you how many people I've met in the industry who make money, have careers, but they're soul sick. Because after 10 or 15 years, this is what I'm doing with my life? We don't have to name titles of movies. You can name any title you want. You know what I'm talking about. This is what I'm doing with my life? I'm taking part, my talent and my gift, in this pollution, in this soul-killing pollution? Now, don't mistake me. I'm not talking about tragedy versus comedy or light versus heavy. No, anything goes. Anything goes, the more the better. I'm talking about stuff which is soul-killing. We all know what it is. And people get sucked into it because they think they have to do it for their careers. No, you don't. If we, the filmmakers, stood up and just don't participate in it, they'd have nothing left but hacks doing that kind of stuff, and things would change. So I think it's very important to hold on to your voice, to not surrender, and to be courageous in whatever it is you want to say.
Ron Maxwell, it's been a pleasure being with you today. Ladies and gentlemen, our guest has been Ron Maxwell. I'm Rick Davis for Studio A. Thanks for watching.